Hi, good morning. Welcome. You can come join the table. It's not church. You can get closer. if we pass around a basket, then, you know, do what you will. Hi, my name is Sarah Ladislaw. I'm the Director of the Energy and National Security Program here at CSIS. Welcome this morning to, as I like to say, one of our favorite events of the year when we get to do it, which is the BP Energy Outlook for 2035. We are really, really pleased to have with us once again Mark Finley, who is not only a good friend and frequenter of CSIS Energy Program events, but also one of the main authors of the BP Energy Outlook. We're always amazed that you're able to sort of keep up the constant yearly grind of both the Statistical Review and the BP Energy Outlook. And I know everybody that I can see in the room that works in this space utilizes both of those documents in the work that they do. So we are all sort of indebted to you for doing it. We are also pleased to have the Head of External Affairs and Vice President at BP, Ray Dempsey, here to offer some opening remarks before Mark launches into his presentation. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Ray, and then we'll let Mark do his thing. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. Good morning. Can you hear me, everybody? I told Sarah and Nanny I'd keep my opening remarks to definitely less than 45 minutes. Don't worry. This is not going to be difficult. I am really delighted to be here, and I'll say again express our appreciation to Sarah and the whole team at CSIS for hosting us here. It has been a real delight for us, frankly, at BP to support and follow the important work at CSIS over many years, and we look forward to doing that for many years to come. I guess I can't help but share a bit of good news with all of you, and if you haven't seen this news overnight, it's something that's really important to us. We've announced just late yesterday afternoon that we entered an agreement with the EPA that resolves all matters related to the suspension and debarment of BP, which followed the Deepwater Horizon accident nearly 4 years ago now. This is a great milestone for BP for lots of reasons, because it allows us to participate again in government contracting in the United States, and that's a big part of our business and a big part of our priority. Maybe even more importantly than that, though, it's a chance for us to sort of more fully resume our activities as the largest energy investor in America. I hope you all had heard before that we are indeed the largest energy investor in the United States, because that's something we've been working hard to share, particularly over recent months and maybe as long as a year. We've invested nearly $50 billion in the United States over the last 5 years. That is more than anybody else. It's certainly more than we invest in any other country in the world. And we're committed to the safe production of the energy that America needs. And have been doing that for quite a long time. We, as much as we are committed to the idea of investing the money, we also support a lot of jobs. And so the economic impact of our, say, 260,000 jobs across America is also something that gives us great excitement in being able to return our attention and our energies to how that works with the federal government. The reason we're so proud of this energy outlook, the reason I should make it more personal, is because while we've been doing it for our internal purposes for many years, we've really only started to introduce it externally for the last 4 years. And very quickly, it has become something that people anticipate and await and seem to really value and appreciate. And we're happy for that, because it's not meant to be a commercial. It's not meant to be, BP's recommendation or proposal for the way the world of energy should look. It's really designed and intended to be a very objective view of the way we think the landscape, the global energy landscape, is going to evolve given existing or our view of the policies and the consumer trends and the dynamics that are at play around the world. And hopefully by your presence, it's a reinforcement that you think it's useful too. So we're delighted that that's true. And that's enough of my BP commercial. I hope many of you know already my colleague Mark Finley, who's just about to walk us through this outlook. I love to describe Mark as my friend and colleague who's been in the industry for more than 25 years. I also like to say that he's been claiming that 25 years for about a decade now. And I shouldn't tease him. And with all due respect to his wonderful wife, Leanne, Mark and I have been growing old together in the company for quite a long time now. So he's got a wealth of knowledge, a fistful of degrees, and a great command of this particular subject. So with no further delay, I'll hand it over to Mark Finley.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you, Ray. And is it okay if I stand up and walk around? I'm not 100% Italian, but I'm half that way, and it helps if I can walk and wave my hands while I'm talking.
So, kind of hand-waving range.
Okay, good idea. And your glass of water, too. So thank you all for taking time to join us for this morning for what I hope will become a discussion on energy matters. And it's a privilege to have a chance to share it, especially here at CSIS. You know, we're big fans of the program. And so thank you again for giving us that opportunity. Ray mentioned that this is not the outlook for the world as we wish it would be, but rather it's our best effort to be as objective as we can be. Building on the status and the data in our annual statistical review of world energy, which BP has done for 62 years now, and we try to maintain both a physical connection to the statistical review by building the data on top of that. So all of the historical data in this presentation will be consistent with the statistical review. But also we try to build on the reputation for objectivity. And we try to do our best job in calling it as we see it, taking into account thank you very much.
Just put that in your pocket.
All right. Is that better? Thanks, Annie. Doing our best to take into account, not only the evolution of the world's economy and population and technology, but also policy. And that's, I think, a differentiating aspect of our energy outlook. We'll actually look at how policy we think is likely to evolve as well. And we'll see some examples of that as we go through the presentation. This year, we built our outlook around three themes. We asked if the world could have energy that is sufficient to fuel continued economic growth, secure, something that's been in the headlines already in the last couple of days and we were talking about already, and sustainable. For the purposes of this narrative, at least, we'll look at sustainability through the lens of CO2 emissions. And to give you a sneak preview of the answers, sufficient, yes, secure, it depends, sustainability, not from what we can see. But I think we can make some interesting observations on that as well as we go through. So as we go through this presentation, we'll begin with a review of the high-level data, and then we'll go through it in turn, fuel by fuel, and then step out at the end for a discussion of CO2 emissions and some concluding remarks. What I'm going to do at first is to show you the same picture three times, sliced different ways for perspective. And what I'm showing you is the history and the forecast for global energy consumption. By the way, we convert all forms of energy into the equivalent of a ton of oil so that we can make like-for-like comparisons.
it's the same picture showing you, but now we're slicing it, looking at sector of the economy. Here, you can see very clearly that most of the growth is in the industrial sector. The slowest growing sector by far in our outlook is transport, and we'll come back to that with more detail as we go through the oil section. Notice also, by the way, that we don't show you electricity as a separate sector of the economy. Rather, we distribute electricity through to where it actually gets used. As we will see later in the presentation, power generation actually accounts for the majority of the growth of global energy demand in our outlook. By the way, you may also, if you have very sharp eyes, see the tiny wedge for electricity and transportation, but you'll notice that it's not very much, and we'll come back to that as well. On the right-hand side, again, with the growth increments, you can see that the slowdown of energy demand over the forecast interval is concentrated in the industrial sector. Again, consistent with our view on China's, the changing nature of China's evolution. By the way, let me back up very quickly. Another point. It's important, we feel, to recognize what an outlier China is. You know, if we look back in the historical record, certainly it is the case that as countries get richer, you know, they achieve rapid growth rates of energy demand to fuel that rapid growth of the economy. But even by that historical pattern, China is the outlier. And so we feel that it's important not to base our expectations about how energy demand in other emerging economies will look going forward on China's experience over the last 20 years. In fact, by the end of our outlook, India actually replaces China as the biggest source of energy demand growth in the world, but doesn't replicate the very aggressive growth that we've seen in China, which again, we feel is really the historical outlier. And we can talk more about the reasons for that later if you're interested. The final repetition of the same picture is to slice the data fuel by fuel. So here we're showing you all forms of energy. By the way, we track commercial energy. So when we're reporting, for example, renewable energy, it's renewables that are commercialized in power generation and transportation, not the wood that you burn in your fireplace, et cetera. On that basis, all forms of energy grow in our outlook. The fastest growing group of fuels by far are renewable forms of energy, which grow by over 6% a year. So more than four times faster than the overall energy complex. Therefore, they gain significant market share, but from a relatively small base. Among fossil fuels, the fastest growing fuel is natural gas. The slowest growing fuel globally in our outlook is oil. On the right-hand side, again, you see the changing pattern of growth of energy demand going forward, and in particular, you see the slowdown of coal. Again, consistent with our story about China's shifting pattern. So again, these three slices of the data all reinforce each other in that messaging, that continued economic energy growth, but slowing over time. Now, because we're the pointy-headed nerds that we are, we can't just talk about demand. We have to show you supply, too. So here is our forecast for global energy production, which, of course, rises to keep up with the growth of demand. All forms or all regions of the world see growing energy production, except for one, Europe. Personally, when we put this chart together, I was surprised to learn that Asia was actually the biggest energy producing region in the world today. It's primarily coal in China for today, but going forward, Asia accounts for roughly half of all of the growth in global energy production. And it's not, as we'll see, just a story about coal in China. There are significant increments of new energy supply from other forms of energy in Asia as well. Now, I mentioned earlier that one of our questions was energy, can the world have sufficient energy to keep up with economic growth? And we answered that we're very emphatically, the answer is yes. One of the reasons why is shown on the right-hand chart. What I'm showing you is new forms of energy, which are already coming into the world's energy mix in a material way, and we believe will continue to grow rapidly. Now, this is probably the only presentation you're gonna look at that put renewables, shale gas, tight oil sands, and biofuels all together in one chart with one theme to them. But I think it's a valid theme, which is that due to a combination of market forces and government policies, we are seeing the facilitation of this rapid growth rate, and we believe it's likely to be sustained. In fact, these forms of energy by themselves account for almost half of all of the growth in global energy production in our outlook. And again, in every case, there is a story to be told around, you know, the evolution of market forces and the important role of policy to harness those forces to drive innovation and to facilitate continued robust growth. And again, we will examine each of those in turn as we go through the presentation. The other reason why we're optimistic the world can have the energy it needs is that we don't need it to begin with. The panel on the left shows how much more efficient the world gets using energy relative to economic growth in our outlook. In fact, in our outlook, the world's economy roughly doubles. Energy demand, as I mentioned earlier, only grows by 41%. What it means is that if you calculate how much energy is needed to produce a unit of economic activity, whether it's a dollar or, you know, a euro or other currencies, doesn't matter, the amount of energy needed to produce a unit of economic activity declines by 36%. Slightly faster rate of improvement than we've seen historically. Again, consumers and businesses reacting to higher prices, but also government policy pushing for more efficiency. By the way, keep that visual image in mind, the big gap that opens between energy demand and economic activity. We're going to come back to that concept later. On the right, I'm showing you the long-term evolution of market shares for all forms of energy. Oil today is still the dominant fuel in the world, but has been losing market share structurally for 40 years now. In fact, oil's all-time market share, I'm sure many of you can tell me the exact year when that happened. 1973, that's right. Gold star for God. And oil has lost market share, and the pace at which oil loses market share historically tracks with the price of oil. When oil prices were high in the 70s and early 80s, oil lost market share dramatically. When oil prices collapsed, the erosion of oil's market share slowed down. And in the last dozen years or so, as oil has resumed, you know, prices have gone up, oil's erosion of market share has accelerated once again. In our outlook, oil, even though demand keeps growing, it loses market share. And what's been gaining market share? Well, in the last 10 years, most dramatically, coal, and again, you can see how much the China story in the last 10 or 15 years has been an outlier in the long historical pattern. Eventually, coal begins to lose market share. We've covered that. Structurally, what's gaining market share and continues to do so in our outlook is natural gas and renewables, which pass nuclear power in terms of market share in the middle of our forecast interval, and by the end of it, you know, are roughly equivalent to hydro output as well. Now, of course, what that means is that the world continues to be dominated by fossil fuels in our outlook. Fossil fuels lose market share, but it's still the case that around 80% of the world's energy is met by fossil fuels in our outlook. And that has implications for CO2, which we'll come back to. Another interesting observation, however, is that this endpoint, well, not an endpoint. The world doesn't end in 2035, it's just when our forecast does. In 2035, for the first time in recorded economic history, there will not be a dominant fuel in the world. You know, in the past, two fuels have crossed lines when one was gaining and one was losing. So coal passed wood, oil passed coal. But now, for the first time ever, we'll have three fuels roughly equivalent. And I think it might pose some interesting energy security questions. I mean, what does energy security mean when there's not a dominant fuel? Better minds than mine for, you know, can consider that one, perhaps. I mentioned the role, important role of electricity in our outlook. The majority of growth of energy demand comes from it. It's not just a story of poor countries plugging in. Now, this chart shows the amount of energy used to generate electricity as a share of total energy use. One of the most broadly established trends in the energy markets is that this number grows over time. And the important point that I want to share with you is that here's the emerging economies, which continue to grow, but also here in the rich market economies of the OECD, the share of energy needed to generate electricity continues to go up. You know, it used to be, you know, you had one device that you had to plug in. Now it's two, and, you know, everybody in the house has their own, and so you know the pattern. I don't need to explain that to you. On the right, I'm showing you where the fuel comes from to generate electricity. So remember earlier we talked about how oil has been losing market share structurally around the world? Nowhere more pronounced than in the power generation sector. In 1973, about a quarter of all of the world's electricity came from oil. Today, it's about 4% on its way down to 2% in our outlook. Here in the US, it's already, you know, 1%. So, important point. Where oil faces competition, oil lost a long time ago. As an aside, by the way, who heats their house with heating oil? I don't see a hand up. You know, you would have had a lot more hands, I guarantee it, 40 years ago. So where oil faces competition, oil lost a long time ago. what's been gaining market share. At first, it was nuclear power. When that slowed down, we saw the revenge of fossil fuels, with coal and natural gas both gaining share. In recent years, it's been renewables, and that continues in our outlook, exceeding 10% of total power generation by 2035. We can also use the data in our outlook to make some observations on those second and third questions I posed earlier, security and sustainability. The proxy for thinking about security and one dimension of it, we'll look about trade. The panel on the left here shows regional imbalances of energy. Now, I will freely confess that we don't forecast bilateral trade relationships. I just don't have time to go through every fuel and every bilateral trading relationship. So this is a proxy for trade, just looking at, for example, is North America a producer or an importer or exporter of oil, then gas, then coal? And we aggregate those regional imbalances to put this picture together. The way to read the chart is if you're below the line, you import. If you're above the line, you export. Historically, for those of you who have suffered through our statistical review presentations in the past, you will have seen charts like this, and the message historically has been, once a region becomes a net importer, it's game over. All you ever do is import more and more and more. But that's no longer the case. Here in North America, we've been reducing import dependence significantly, and in fact, in our outlook, North America switches sides, becoming a significant net exporter of energy. On our data, all of the net growth in world energy imports accrue to Asia. On the right-hand side, I'm showing you the implications of our outlook for CO2 emissions, at least CO2 emissions from energy use, which grow by a hair less than 30%, not as rapid as energy consumption, because remember, the fuels that are gaining market share are the low-carbon sources of energy, renewables and natural gas, but still growing. But not, much of a gap opening between these two. Contrasting with the example we saw earlier from economic growth and energy use, which is becoming much more of a noticeable gap. We're going to come back to that. So let me move next into an examination of the data fuel by fuel. We'll begin with the biggest fuel for now, oil. Well, I should say liquids, because we include biofuels and small amounts of gas and coal to liquids as well, but it's primarily oil. The way to read this chart, first notice that we've switched units. A million barrels a day, which is of course the convention when we talk about liquid fuels. We read the chart by beginning with the level of demand and supply in the world in 2012, and then showing you total increments over the forecast interval. I mentioned earlier that oil is by far the weakest growing fuel in our outlook, but it is still the case that global demand grows by 19 million barrels a day, roughly equivalent to adding a new Saudi Arabia and a new United States to production over that interval. On the demand side, again, those of you who are familiar with BP's work know that we're not big fans of the peak oil supply argument. But peak oil demand, we believe that we've already seen it here in the US and in the other mature market economies of the OECD, where again, a combination of consumers reacting to high prices, mature economies, and government policies that really push for fuel efficiency will result in a long-term structural decline in oil consumption. But all of those declines in all of those countries are offset by growth in one country, China, and then we add the incremental growth on top of that for the other emerging economies to get to a figure of aggregate growth of 19 million barrels a day. And where does the supply come from to meet that? The biggest increment by far is outside of OPEC, and in particular driven by those unconventional sources of supply that we mentioned earlier. Tight oil in the United States, Canadian oil sands. In fact, if we include growth of deep water production in the United States and in Brazil, the Western Hemisphere accounts for almost all of this net growth outside of OPEC. And by the way, this is also taking into account declines in mature provinces like the North Sea and Alaska. The remaining slice is met by OPEC, and here we break out the growth between crude oil and natural gas liquids because, as we will see, there's an important distinction there. The distinction is that OPEC quotas only apply to crude oil. And we'll come back to that. So first, a bit of detail on the demand side. I mentioned earlier that we're going to look in more detail at transportation. We talked about declining consumption in the OECD countries, and you can see that that is concentrated in the transport sector. But in the emerging economies, there's a different story. Significant growth not only in transport, but also in industrial applications. And in fact, on the right-hand side, I'm showing you that familiar pattern of growth in increments over time of our forecast. Remember earlier, for the global total, we said that the slowdown of growth of demand in our forecast is concentrated in industry. not the case for oil. In oil, the slowdown is concentrated in transportation. Well, why is that? Well, we'll come back to the transport part shortly. But what turns out is that for oil in industrial applications, there are certain base load uses of oil that cannot be easily substituted away. In petrochemicals, for example, or asphalt for roads. And so, as industrial output grows in the emerging economies, there is a baseload need for more oil demand that cannot easily be substituted away by other fuels. Next up is the supply. On the left-hand side, I'm just showing you the evolution over time. What I want to really focus on are these wedges, and in particular on tight oil, which, of course, is on everyone's mind these days. On the right, I'm showing you our forecast for tight oil. Last year, we spent more time talking about this, so I'm not going to go into the whole laundry list of reasons why this is important. But these numbers are truly staggering. And by the way, when you study history, like we do with the statistical review, and by the way, it's not a slog, it's a labor of love. It's a you're not prone to use superlatives. Because if you look far enough back in history, there's always somebody who's bigger and stronger and faster. But this is big. Last year, in fact, for 2 years in a row now, the United States has had the biggest increase in oil production in the world and the biggest increase in the entire history of the United States going all the way back to Colonel Drake at Titusville. And we can even go further than that. If we look at the increase in U.S. oil production last year, it ranks as one of the biggest increases in oil production the world has ever seen. In fact, only one country has ever had a bigger increase in oil production than the U.S. did last year. And that was Saudi Arabia. The Saudis have done it a number of times, but many of those were when there was a crisis and the Saudis were tapping already existing spare production capacity. If we look at the organic growth of production, the Saudis have only done it three times, in the early run-up to the Arab oil embargo, and once in the most recent decade when there was very strong growth of demand and new capacity being brought on. So this increase in the United States was, on our data, the fourth biggest increase of organic production in the history of the world. So big, big, big numbers. And we project that it will continue to grow. Eventually, those growth rates will moderate. In the United States, production will begin to plateau. Production elsewhere grows, but not to the game-changing degree that we've seen in the United States. And again, we can come back to this if you're interested. Globally, we think production will approach about 7 million barrels a day, about 7% of the global total. And remember, keep that visual image in mind. Rapid growth for the next few years and then beginning to moderate. The reason why that's important is because of the implications it has for the market's requirement for oil production from OPEC. What I'm showing you on the left-hand side is the history and the forecast for the market's requirement for OPEC crude oil production in the red. And in our outlook, indeed, it goes down over the next few years. The market, with rapid growth of unconventional supply and with moderate demand growth, we think that the market will require less oil from OPEC. We believe that OPEC members will cut production in the face of this in an effort to try to sustain prices. But when you cut production, guess what? Spare capacity goes up. This is where cartels historically have run into trouble. Another word for spare capacity is, it's maybe not a real word, but I would say cheatability. And so I think this is part of the challenge. Now, that's a temporary factor. Eventually, remember that growth of tight oil begins to slow down. OPEC recovers its market share, spare capacity tightens again. And by the way, the dynamics that we're describing over the medium term are nothing like what the oil market went through in the 1980s. And so while we do project in our outlook that OPEC will have to work harder, we're not calling for a repeat of the extreme circumstances that the market saw in the 1980s. I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge another dimension of the oil market, which is the turmoil and the loss of supply associated with events in the Middle East and North Africa, many of which under the rubric of what has come to be known as the Arab Spring. You may have been wondering, as I'm talking about all this wonderful growth of U.S. oil production, why hasn't it impacted prices? And the answer is that disruptions elsewhere have basically matched the growth of U.S. oil production barrel for barrel over the last 3 years. And by the way, our study and review of historical data suggests that there's reason to be concerned about that going forward. The historical record shows that when supplies get disrupted due to civil unrest, civil wars, etc., it doesn't come back quickly. In fact, in many cases, it doesn't come back at all. Libya to this day has never produced what it was producing before Gaddafi took over 1970. Iran has never produced what it was producing in the late 70s before the Shah fell. And so a review of this data means, you know, to us that looking at these disruptions, you know, we have to be cautious about the prospects for a quick and speedy return of this supply. And we've actually used this data to increase our provisions for supply disruptions that sit behind our outlook. A bit more context on the pressures on OPEC producers. On the left-hand side, I'm showing you, in all three of these charts, I'm showing you the data over the history and our forecast for OPEC countries, other emerging economies, and then the OECD countries. So, you know, in our outlook, OPEC countries continue to have the most rapid growth of population. But if you're wondering why these countries have, you know, been at the epicenter of the unrest that we've seen in much of the Middle East and North Africa, over the last 40 years, per capita income in the emerging economies outside of OPEC has tripled. In the OECD countries, it's doubled. In the OPEC countries, it hasn't moved at all for 40 years. By the way, on our outlook, the prospects for continued growth of export revenues are also constrained by the market dynamics that I described earlier, a contributing factor to which, by the way, is rapid growth of energy demand in these countries themselves. And so the prospects for, you know, feeding rapid economic growth through a dramatic growth of exports going forward is constrained in our outlook, at least. Now, we can use our data to make the same observations about oil that we started with energy earlier, about trade and import dependence. So the center panel, it just looks at what we already looked at for the total energy complex, only for oil. So North America is on a trajectory to become self-sufficient and, in fact, to become a net exporter of oil. All of the net growth of oil imports in our outlook come from Asia. And by the way, as a share of the total, Middle East share of oil exports actually doesn't change at all. So I know in a lot of policy circles there's a lot of focus on, China is going to be much more dependent on the Middle East and, you know, this is going to have big strategic ramifications. Our data says actually that Asia's, you know, going to have to look way beyond the Middle East for incremental barrels of supply from the former Soviet Union, from Africa, and from the Western Hemisphere as well. You know, that indeed the incremental barrel to supply growing Asian imports will not come in the Middle East. Then we look at the implications for import dependence, and we can compare and contrast the United States and China on the far sides of these panels. So here in the U.S., the story is well documented. Import dependence has already dropped significantly due to declining consumption and rising domestic supply. In fact, the U.S. has reduced its import dependence, equivalent to removing the world's third biggest oil consumer from the market over the last 5 years, Japan. That's how big the turnaround has been. On our data, those trends continue, but the U.S. does not achieve self-sufficiency. The U.S. remains a small net importer of oil, about 1 million barrels a day by 2035. Contrast with the projections for China, which, if it hasn't already, will this year overtake the U.S. as the biggest importer of oil in the world and as the biggest consumer in the later years of our outlook. And all of that growth of demand comes from imports. Our outlook for overall Chinese oil production is relatively stable. What it means is that, in terms of both barrels a day and as a share of consumption, China's oil import dependence is a much bigger issue than anything the United States has ever had to grapple with. Now, I mentioned we would look in more detail at transportation. I mentioned also that transport is the weakest growing outlook, or sector in our outlook. And some people have said, well, does that mean, how can you say people aren't going to buy cars in the emerging economies? And just to be clear, that is not what we're saying. We believe that the world vehicle fleet will double. In fact, the vehicle fleet in the emerging economies will triple. But energy demand in the transport sector actually goes down in the OECD, even as the car fleet goes up. And while the car fleet triples in the emerging economy, energy demand only grows by 81%. So obviously, you know, it's not that we're not projecting people are, you know, going to avoid buying cars. There's something else at play. And just as obviously, what that something else is fuel efficiency. And by the way, I need to apologize. This chart is, you know, its headquarters are in London. What can I say? You know, here in the U.S., we would say miles per gallon, and to show greater fuel efficiency, the line would go up. But, you know, the units are reversed by convention of how to track fuel efficiency in Europe. So trust me, down is up. What I'm showing you is fuel efficiency. And by the way, notice that the dramatic improvement of fuel efficiency in new cars is not only in the rich countries of the world. And by the way, how to achieve this? We work, as you can imagine, this is a core area for BP to be interested in. So we, every year, are always talking to the battery makers and the national laboratories and the auto companies and the policy makers, and we array all the technology options and do our best to understand their relative costs and the merits, and every year what comes back is make the internal combustion engine more fuel efficient, supplemented with hybrid technology. So by 2035, 3/4 of the world's new car sales have some form of hybrid technology in them. You do see a line up here at the top that says plug-ins and battery electrics. They're primarily plug-ins. We don't really have that much pure electric vehicles in our outlook. The cost, the range limitations, look to be significant limiting factors to us. Now again, an important caveat, this is premised on what we can see today. If there's a breakthrough on battery technology, if there's a more aggressive policy stance, these numbers could be different. But again, based on what we see today, this looks like the most likely trajectory. Now the implications of that are a couple of things. One, we've already talked about, transport is the weakest growing sector in our outlook. But two, transport continues to be dominated by oil. You can see, in fact, that on our data, oil accounts for still, by 2035, about 87% of all of the energy consumed in the transport sector. And that's even after we made a big upward revision this year to the amount of natural gas used in transport. That primarily is in liquefied natural gas in big applications like shipping, long-haul trucking, rail applications. We still think that, we aren't at liberty to talk about the price forecasts that sit behind our outlook, it doesn't look to us like compressed natural gas, is a competitive option going forward. Speaking of natural gas, why don't we move there? I mentioned earlier that natural gas is the fastest growing fossil fuel in our outlook. Unlike oil, it grows in the mature market economies of the OECD, but it's still the case that 75 to 80% of that growth is in the emerging economies. On the right-hand side, I'm showing you the sectoral breakdown. It doesn't change dramatically in our outlook. You do begin to see that wedge of transport and a bit squeezed in other, which is primarily residential and commercial applications. Remember, this is market share, not levels. On the supply side, it's actually the case that for all of the focus on shale, that's not where most of the growth of supply comes from. The vast majority of the growth of production comes from conventional natural gas supply outside of the OECD. That said, shale is a much bigger deal for gas than it is for oil. Globally, we believe that shale gas production will achieve a global market share of about 21%. Remember, for oil, it was only about 7%. Similar story, dominated by North America, rapid growth in the near term, beginning to slow down in the later years, partly offset by growth in other countries that is significant, but not game-changing to the degree that we've seen here. On the trade story, again, a familiar pattern. North America becomes a significant net exporter, and much of the growth, if not all of it, on the import side, is in Asia. Now, on the right-hand side, I'm showing you the evolution of trade as a share of the world total, which doesn't change much, but within that, where the growth is in liquefied natural gas trade. And the reason why that's important is because those ship-bound cargoes have the opportunity to move between different regions of the world and to begin to provide more connectivity between what are, at least today, still largely disconnected regional markets. Again, a familiar pattern of import dependence. We looked at this concept for the oil charts. Here, we're looking at it for natural gas, and we're comparing the projections for the North America, Europe, and China. So in North America, significant growth of consumption fueled by rapid growth of production of shale gas and making room for significant net exports from the region as well. In contrast, European consumption grows, but grows slowly. However, domestic production continues to decline, meaning that import dependence increases significantly. And then on the far right, we see China, which actually has the biggest growth increment for natural gas of any country in our forecast. By 2035, China is consuming what all of Europe does. And that growth of demand is fueled by significant increase in domestic production, including big increments of not only shale gas, but also other unconventional supply, primarily coal bed methane, but also significant increases of imports via both pipelines and liquefied natural gas. So again, for China, the story is growing import dependence for oil, growing import dependence for natural gas. While we don't show it in our data, also, believe it or not, import dependence for coal as well. It has become fashionable in economic circles in recent years to talk about real experiments. So we economists have been focused on getting away from our cubicles and trying to get out in the real world and find examples of our nice theories. Whether you realize it or not, you've actually been participating in one in the last 10 years. The real experiment is this. Let's take an isolated geographic marketplace for natural gas, drop a whopping big new source of supply on it, and let's see what happens. You know, we pointy-headed economists would say, well, supply should, you know, be impacted, demand should be impacted, and maybe if it's disconnected regional market, there should be efforts to connect it with trade. So let's look at the data. On the left-hand side, the supply reaction. Maybe I'm just a pointy-headed nerd, but if you'd asked me if I had a rig and I wanted to look for $100 oil or $4 natural gas, I would have picked $100 oil. And that's exactly what's happening. A decade ago, 3/4 of the rigs in the United States were looking for natural gas. Today, 3/4 of the rigs are looking for oil, in case you're wondering why U.S. oil production is taking off. So there's the supply reaction. On the demand side, again, let's, you know, pull out our Econ 101 textbook and ask ourselves, so if the price of natural gas, you know, gets very cheap, what happens? Well, people will try to consume it, but where can it go quickly? It turned out that there was only one place in the U.S. economy where it could go quickly. Because 10 years ago, people built a lot of new natural gas-fired power plants as the gas and power markets were being deregulated. And so that gas didn't require a lot of new investment to find a home in power generation. However, other sectors of the economy, people had to invest to build new capacity to consume natural gas. So here's my thought process. If you want to convert a factory, if you own a factory and you want to burn natural gas because it's cheap, you switch out your boilers or your burners, you maybe run a little pipe to connect to a grid that's already there, and off you go. If you want to switch your car to natural gas, there's a lot more moving parts. You not only need to, you know, retool your car, you need to figure out where the refueling infrastructure is going to be. So there's, you know, a more complicated set of transactions. As an economist, I would say that the economic signal has to be the bigger and longer to provide the incentives to move it into transport. And that's exactly what we see. We're already seeing the reaction on the industrial side, but only later do we begin to see the implications for transport. So again, on the demand side, there's been a very clear phased reaction to cheaper natural gas. First in power generation, where the capacity was already there to use it, then in industry, and only later in transport because it's a more complicated set of transactions. And as I mentioned earlier, there's also a response on the trade side. Again, maybe I'm just the pointy-headed nerd, but if you had the opportunity to sell gas for $4 at Henry Hub or $18 in Japan, which would you rather do? And we've seen, in fact, you know, now we've seen a number of LNG permits already issued. Here's our forecast for U.S. net natural gas exports. In fact, on our data, the United States becomes the second biggest exporter of natural gas in the world, behind only Australia in the later years of the forecast. We can further observe that on our projections, global liquefied natural gas trade becomes more diverse or less concentrated. Today, the biggest supplier in the world, Qatar, has about a 1/3 market share. Going forward, then you see a much more diversity of supply going forward. And I think that might have some interesting strategic and market ramifications as well. So let's move on to other forms of energy. I won't dwell on coal because we've already really talked about it. You know, going forward, in fact, you can see the growth increments for China not only slow down, they cease. In the last 10 years of our outlook, Chinese coal consumption actually stops growing, you know, due to the combination of the slower growth of the economy and the change in the industrial makeup that we mentioned, but also rising consumption of natural gas and, as we will see, non-fossil forms of energy as well. Speaking of other non-fossil forms of energy, here they are. And here we've broken out the data in terms of the OECD and non-OECD countries. So here's the implications of the tragedy at Fukushima. We do write down our forecast for nuclear power on the face of that. Moreover, now that we've extended our outlook to 2035, we begin to see a dip in nuclear power in the very later years of our forecast. That's actually primarily driven by an expectation that nuclear power plants here in the United States will begin to reach the end of their safe operating lives and can no longer be relicensed for continued operations, and we begin to see significant retirements of old nuclear power plants at the tail end of this. Meanwhile, significant growth of renewables in power generation, and, by the way, significant growth in the emerging economies of nuclear power, where we don't see the evidence that Fukushima has caused a reevaluation of plans to build new plants in India, China, Russia, etc., but also growth of large-scale hydropower, where the opportunities are limited, but still some significant growth. I mentioned the importance of renewables in power generation in particular. Globally, it gets to over 10% of the total. The biggest increment by far is actually China. And yet, China, while the use of renewables in power generation grows significantly, it doesn't get anywhere near to the penetration of the United States, or most especially in Europe, which will see more than 30% of its power coming from renewable sources by 2035. Well, why is that? If this is so big, why don't we see a bigger number here? And the answer is, what's on the bottom of the fraction? In Europe, there's not much growth of power demand, whereas in China, the bottom side, the total demand for electricity continues to grow very robustly. By the way, on renewables, especially renewables and power generation, this outlook for continued aggressive growth is premised on not only an expectation of continued supportive government policy, including eventually efforts to begin to deal with the challenge of climate, but also a view that technology, the learning curve will continue, that we'll see reductions in cost as these technologies scale up. In the early years of our outlook, most of the growth is in wind, but actually we believe that the opportunities to improve the economics of the projects is that better in solar. It's a less mature technology. So especially in the later years of our outlook, the growth rate for solar is actually much higher. Now, I mentioned I wanted to come back and look at the implications of this for CO2 emissions of our outlook. Here's the raw data. Again, overall CO2 emissions in our data rise by about, or CO2 from energy use, rise by about 30%. There it is. All of the growth is in the emerging economies. CO2 emissions in the US and the EU and the other mature market economies continues to fall. But who cares? That's irrelevant. It's a global problem. The red dotted line is what the climate scientists say the trajectory needs to look like if we are to be on a path to stabilize atmospheric concentrations at 450 parts per million. Manifestly, we are not on that trajectory. On the right-hand side, again, we see the declining per capita emissions in the OECD countries, but that's offset by significant increases elsewhere. Now, we can actually think about this in a couple of different ways. We can break CO2 emissions down into component parts. The first part is, how much energy do you need to run your economy? The second part is, how much carbon do you need to fuel your energy mix? So we'll look at those two separately. On the left, we're showing you the relationship between energy and the economy. We talked about it earlier. Significant improvements over time and going forward. In our outlook, they improve the energy intensity of the world's economic and energy complex improves by 36%. But there's something else interesting to point out. Look at the convergence over time. The gap between how countries use energy relative to their economic system has been narrowing. In fact, we've drawn this chart back to the beginning of the industrial era. It's never been as narrow as it is today. And you can see in our outlook, it continues to synchronize. This is the awesome power of globalization at work, not only in the trade of energy, but in the trade of global goods and services as well. And it's driven by markets. Then contrast that with the experience on the right-hand side. We talked about it earlier. There is a bit of improvement in the carbon intensity of the world's energy mix, but not a lot. Not, in fact, primarily driven by climate policy. But also, no harmonization between countries. There's no, those gaps are as wide as they ever were. In the absence of climate policy, there's no incentive or there's no reason why countries should use carbon in a similar fashion around the world. So here's an example of this, and I apologize, this is a busy chart. What I'm showing you here is the share of the dominant fuel in a country's energy mix, and we've looked at 20 major economies around the world, and again, we've gone back 100 years with this data. So there's a couple things to show. First, you can see that in general, the pattern of these dots tends to go down over time. That is to say, the fuel mix diversifies. You know, you're no longer dependent on one fuel. If it's 100%, you're dependent on one fuel. But also, you see the color scheme changes. It goes from coal being the dominant fuel to oil being the dominant fuel. And now we're starting to see other forms of energy, natural gas and non-fossil forms of energy as a group, you know, becoming the leading source of energy in some countries. So organically, over time, and without climate policy, at least up till now, you've seen already a lightening of the carbon load through the natural evolution of the world's energy system. And then I've shown you just the projections for a couple of the key countries here. You know, in the U.S., natural gas replaces oil as the leading fuel. In the European Union, we see that non-fossil forms of energy as a group become the largest share. China continues to be dominated by coal, but coal continues to lose market share. Now, a big part of what we're seeing over time, and remember we talked about that lightening of the carbon load, nowhere do we see that more, that competition playing out more vigorously than in power generation. So what I'm showing you here is the share of power generation, and we're looking specifically at competition between gas and coal. So what we're seeing is, for example, North America, significant loss of market share for coal and power generation, driven by, not in the first instance, climate policy, but by the shale revolution. In Europe, a different story, and you could make more of an argument that this is policy-driven, including more recent years in climate policy. In China, significant loss of market share for coal and power generation, beginning to see natural gas coming into the mix. I'm sure you all know, and many people in this room know better than I do, the stories around air pollution and concerns about that in China. But in the absence of, again, a global carbon price, part of the message of our outlook is that when countries reach the stage of rapid economic growth, they're going to use what they have. So, for example, this story of coal losing market share to natural gas is not uniform. In other emerging economies, for example, we actually project that coal will gain market share because, again, they're reaching that point of rapid economic growth, and what they have at hand is coal. Now, we can use these observations to wrap this up. We've already shown you the data on the left, the big gap that opens between economic growth and energy consumption, the not-so-big gap between energy consumption and CO2. We can play a thought experiment. If we took today's relationships between energy, economic growth, and carbon and froze them and just let the economy grow as we're projecting, global CO2 emissions would grow by more than 30 billion tons per year. In the event they only grow by 10 billion tons per year by 2035, that's still too much, but the reason why it doesn't grow even more rapidly is almost exclusively because of this dramatic improvement of energy intensity that we're projecting. What it suggests to us is that, you know, when the time is right to engage more forcefully on the climate front, this might be where the low-hanging fruit is. So let me come back. And thanks for hanging in there. I hope I haven't run too far over time. We started out asking three questions. Can the world have energy that's sufficient, secure, and sustainable? On the first case, you know, we answer an enthusiastic yes, the world can have the energy it needs to fuel continued economic growth. You know, due to a combination of new forms of energy working their way into the mix in a material way, but also significant improvements of energy efficiency. In both cases, these significant improvements that lead us to an optimistic view are driven by market forces, harnessed and encouraged by government policies that provide incentives for competition and therefore innovation. Then we turn to security, a great story for North America, which becomes a net energy exporter, including the U.S., which achieves self-sufficiency overall in energy, and I didn't use the word independence on purpose. But a mixed story because we see prospects for increases in import dependency in Europe and most pronounced in emerging economies in Asia. And then finally on sustainability, CO2 emissions grow. No way, there's no sugarcoating it in our outlook. They don't grow as quickly as energy use, but they're still growing when at a time when climate scientists say they should be falling. I would offer that if we think about why we're optimistic on the first, there might be some observations for the second and the third questions here. You know, so security. If Japan had truly been an island at the time of Fukushima, how much more difficult would the country's experience been and the tragedy and the impact of it on the Japanese people if Japan hadn't been able to be dependent and able to plug into flexible markets around the world to rapidly bring in large quantities of alternative sources of energy to offset the loss of nuclear power? So again, the observation is that markets can be, you know, can help in the cause of energy security. And growing import dependence need not be a cause for concern. On the sustainability front, similar argument. You've seen our data where we suggest that, you know, the reason why we've become much more efficient is because energy is expensive. And that suggests that there's opportunities to become more carbon efficient, you know, if there were to be a cost on carbon. So again, the observation on the first point about the importance of markets and government policies that facilitate the functioning of those markets to incentivize competition and innovation, you know, could offer constructive policy observations for the second and third questions. Let me just wrap up by noting that all of this information is available on our website, which is here, and you can download the data. There's a lot of resources that you can tap into. If you're so inclined, you can follow us on Twitter. I never would have imagined that part of my job would be to describe all of this in 140 words or less. I bet you wish that I could do that now. but most importantly, you know, I hope that this is a useful resource for you. I want to thank you for your time, and hopefully we've left some time for discussion as well. So thank you again.
That's great. Mark, as usual, it was a tour de force. That was wonderful. Thank you. We have about 15 minutes left for questions, and I wanted to take you up on two real quick. One was you offered to explain why China is such an outlier in terms of its consumption and how it plays out in the forecast, so I'd like to take you up on that. And then the second is you, in a very sort of interesting and thought-provoking kind of way, talk about sustainability, but really only in light of climate change. And right. So, but I'm sure you thought about other sustainability aspects as well, so I wanted to give you a chance to expand on whether, you know, water, local pollution, some of those other issues are, you know, how those things fed into how you were looking at this.
Okay, thanks. And so on China, let me start with, again, the objective observation that even taking into account the size of China's economy and its population, the intensity of its energy development is qualitatively different from other countries that have gone through the same process. So the question is, what is it that's different? And, you know, I would defer to the China experts. My personal theory is the one-child policy, you know, which, you know, left China in a situation of needing to become rich fast, you know, before it got old, you know, with a very discrete window. And those demographics simply are not repeated anywhere else. And therefore, you know, the urgency is different, and the demographics that shape it. Again, that is a personal theory, but I think it's, well, I'd be interested in other thoughts. On the sustainability front, you're absolutely right. There's a lot of ways to think about sustainability, and we have. In fact, if many of you may be aware, but if you're not, BP actually is undertaking a project that we call the Energy Sustainability Challenge. I think some of people have briefed it here.
Yes.
So the concept was, let's fund independent academic research on lots of different dimensions of sustainability. And I'm going to, you know, give you the non-technical summary here. It's on our website if you want to get more detail, and we've looked at most particularly at water. But as we looked across the range of water, land requirements, rare earth minerals, clearly there are issues, but at a global scale, issues that can be managed once they are measured and once you unleash the creativity of the engineers on them. And so, you know, while these are all significant challenges, they are, at least based on the independent research that we are seeing so far, manageable ones. Ray, is there anything you want to add on that front?
Okay, well, we'll open it up for questions. The only ground rules, please state your name and your affiliation, and then question in the form of a question would be great. Thanks.
Ariel Cohen, head of International Energy and the Heritage Foundation. If you're looking at the fastest rising,
if you're looking at the fastest rising gas producing onshore, offshore, and shale, can you give us a top five, top 10 maybe? Thank you. From now to 2025, I won't push you, 2035.
The fastest growing producers of natural gas?
Projected. Basins, not countries.
Basins. I'm sorry, I don't have that information, that degree of granularity, so I'd have to get it for you. I mean, clearly the big growth increments, United States, LNG, shale, U.S. shale, Australia, big LNG projects, China, which is both coal bed methane and shale. I mean, those are the ones that jump off the chart for me. I'd have to look at it to see. You saw on the chart that African countries as a group become significant net exporters of natural gas through liquefied natural gas trade. If you want to follow up, we can get you the specific breakdown of that.
Thank you.
Hi, Dave Garman with Decker Garman Sullivan. This great presentation. Thanks very much. You've probably looked at this because you show EU gas demand growing for electric power generation. And I was wondering how deeply you've drilled down into the dispatch models, particularly as growing renewable shares come online. We've been doing the same thing, looking at what natural gas will be doing in Europe in the coming years. And that's particularly, headline relevant due to, Ukraine and how dependent will Europe be on Russia,
right,
and other gas sources in the future. And sort of what we're seeing is that the Europeans are just going to have to build a shadow system based largely on gas due to the variability and intermittency of renewables. And I was just seeing how dispatch happens,
right,
in those northern European countries particularly. I wondered if you were seeing the same thing.
We've tried to look at that in a fair degree of detail, and the answer is, the question for us was, is there some glass ceiling for renewables beyond which the sustainability and reliability of the grid can't be assured? And at least as we've looked into it, the numbers that we've got, so upwards of 30% is still a manageable load given the profile of demand and the flexibility of the system as we understand it. And this is, a deregulated market, and made significant inroads into that front. For example, in the very short term, we've actually seen Europe burning more coal in the last couple of years. I'm sure that's a dynamic that's well covered by many people in this room. But with a climate policy, with a recession and with rapid growth of renewables, there wasn't much of a price of carbon. And so, in the very short term, more coal could be used, and the surplus coal being thrown off in the U.S. by U.S. shale gas. I think going forward, we do try to incorporate those both market forces, the regulatory environment, the physical, requirements of the grid and its reliability all go into this.
One point, Guy Caruso, CSIS. One point, you had natural gas in the U.S. power sector sharply declining. It looked like right after the current period for the next, it looks like a few years. And I was wondering how that. And the second one is, could you give us your take on the mismatch in the U.S. refinery sector of this lot of light tight oil coming on stream and how that might play out?
Well, okay, so the first one, yes, you're exactly right. We do believe that gas has already begun to lose market share to coal. Markets work, competition happens. And over the next few years, as the U.S. begins to export liquefied natural gas, as we see more natural gas going into higher value-added applications like industrial use, And the economic incentive to produce natural gas continues to be slanted toward oil instead by prices. You know, what we've seen is fuels compete. And, you know, as natural gas has become more expensive relative to coal, people have used more coal instead. So, yes, you're right. That is a cyclical dimension, you know, amid a structural trend. But the structural trend is still for the gas to, you know, over time to displace coal, driven in large part by economics, but also by policy, you know, around particulate emissions and other dimensions, including eventually climate policy.
Just a quick clarification, does that outlook include sort of the proposed EPA regulations on carbon pollution within the power generation sector?
I don't want to say definitively yes, because I don't know the details of the specific policy, but in general, the concept that policy will that coal will be impacted by policy going forward in power generation is definitely part of the outlook. And on oil exports. Yeah, so.
You didn't use it.
Okay, well, clearly, we have assumed for the purposes of this outlook that eventually economically rational trade to rebalance the mismatch between crude oil, domestic light crude oil production, and refining capacity that is optimized for heavier and more sour grades of crude does begin to occur, but we recognize that that's a massive political uncertainty and a significant decision that's yet to be made. In the meanwhile, we can already observe that the United States has structurally, we've seen the massive disconnect in the prices. U.S. refineries are running at, you know, record high utilization rates, and the U.S. has moved to being a net exporter of refined products for the first time in at least the post-war era in a structural way. But it's a suboptimal solution because the refineries aren't optimized, along that dimension. How's that for a non-answer answer?
Mark, that was great. Frank Verastro, CSIS. So two questions. So one point on a slide where you showed natural gas and oil, it's like rigs in production. We don't capture associated gas in the gas rig count, right? It's captured in the oil rig count, right?
True. What I was showing was just production volume, right, so that wasn't rigs. But yeah, I mean, it's always an art form saying, are you drilling for oil or gas? Yeah. You drill for gas and you get liquids. You drill for oil and you get gas, and so it's. I mean, you have to get Baker Hughes to identify that.
The second question is, this isn't working. Natural gas, liquids, and OPEC, right? So you actually have your wedge, which is an interesting thing because it's not covered by the OPEC quota system. When you look at the surge of volume, because we switched now from an oil economy to a liquids definition, how does that play out?
Tell me a little bit more
the liquids, so who has the liquids, where they go? In past, the BP charts, one of them has always been the trade flows chart that shows up, right? And so it's not in this slide deck, but I'm sure it's in your data.
Yeah.
We've been looking at the product changes or liquids changes and what that means for regional trade, mm-hmm. as well as global trade, and how it shifts back and forth from, you know, a 10-year period and then moves as refineries. So this goes back to Guy's question. As refineries get built and you optimize refineries in Asia or the Middle East and they send products to Europe, right, and European refineries can't compete with the U.S. and they go down, how does that geopolitical dependence shift?
Right. We could have a whole conversation just about that. It has certainly become a lot more complicated. We, like everybody, used to just do, here's our oil balance, and just, everything would kind of price off the international price. Now WTI and Brent have become disconnected, but also U.S.-based, natural gas liquids, propane and butane have all become significantly discounted as well. And it's become clear that you can't just look at the global liquids market. You have to break out all those various components if you want to understand them each, because you can't just assume that they're all going to track with each other anymore. We, like everybody else, are trying our best to get our heads around all of these different moving parts. And we do look in the outlook, it's not in the presentation, at some of the implications for the global refining sector. you know, because as you note, a lot of the growth of production that's in our outlook is not something that goes through a classical refinery, whether it's condensate, natural gas liquids, biofuels. In fact, you know, I don't know if it's in this year's outlook, but we've had it in the past, observe that taking that into account, and if you assume that China continues with its policy of being more or less self-sufficient in refining capacity, the rest of the world never needs to build another new grassroots refinery. You know, and globally, we tend to think that refining is a very competitive industry over long time periods. It's difficult to earn your rate of return, you know, but, you know, specific bits of it, you know, going back to the granularity, you know, the specific refineries, if they're advantaged in terms of their access to a, you know, source of demand or a source of supply, can still be competitive within that globally very competitive mix. And so you do have to really break it down.
So we'll have a further discussion.
Yes. Bob Wright, Department of Energy. On the sustainability issue, you obviously indicate the outlook isn't that good. I'm asking, what do you tell your shareholders who are interested that you're trying to do something about? The only company I know that really heavily involved now is Shell with their Quest project in Alberta. At one point, you had Insala and were very active, and I guess given the uncertainty, you have backed down. I'm sure you're still concerned, but what do you tell the shareholders?
Ray, do you want to take that? Or, yeah.
Well, you can start now.
How about, okay. I'll start. You know, at the end of the day, we view ourselves as being in the business of supplying mobility, you know, light, heat, you know, to our customers. You know, and right now, that's primarily, you know, 87% of the world's, you know, energy mix today is fossil fuels. So the reality of delivering the what consumers are demanding from us, you know, means that we have to supply it with fossil fuels. You know, BP was the very first, you know, major international energy company to come out in favor of more aggressive actions to deal with climate change. We still support that. You know, we have a preference for market-oriented approaches to doing it. And at the same time, we have, you know, continue to have and grow investments, you know, outside of the fossil fuel space aimed at the same concept of delivering light, heat, and mobility to people. We have a significant biofuels business focused in Brazil. We're looking for next-generation biofuels and funding research here in the United States. We've got 1,000 wind turbines spinning in the U.S. right now. And so, you know, we're always looking for, across the technology space, for where are the opportunities to deliver those concepts to consumers. And in the meanwhile, also having to live in the here and now, which, you know, by and large means that for right now, it's fossil fuels.
Yeah, that's a great response. And I wanted to buy myself time to think about both the shape of your question and the reality of, indeed, how do we talk about this with our shareholders? Because as Mark pointed out, we were, I would argue, the early sort of energy company that made observations and even commitments related to the impact that we have on broader issues around climate. As far back as the late 1980s, our former CEO, Lord John Brown, made a couple of speeches, in fact, at Stanford University and made some pretty strong assertions about the reality that while the science may be debatable or perhaps incomplete, there seems to be something happening. And what we do in our industry seems to be a contributor, and therefore we ought to do something about it. The reality today, though, is our shareholders do have an interesting combination of expectations for us. They want us to generate a return. They hold us accountable to that, and indeed that is, in the end, it's our license to continue to exist. And they want us to continue to work towards those ambitions that we have articulated over now, you know, a couple of decades around finding ways to continue to mitigate the implications in emissions and broadly in contribution to challenges to the climate. We have invested a lot of money in the alternatives and renewable space. We've invested now some $8 billion, as we said we would about a decade ago. And while some of those businesses continue to endure and prosper, others we've found it gets harder and harder to compete as an energy company because there's a transition into more of a manufacturing economy. And there are others who are better at that than we have been in sort of the technological development side from an energy point of view. So what we can keep telling our shareholders today is we still do believe what we say. And when we point at the projections in the growth in CO2 emissions of 30%, it still isn't our recommendation or our proposal. Frankly, we don't like it much. And we continue to work on things, even within our own business, to mitigate the emissions of our existing operations and to look for ways to help develop that future low-carbon energy. But as the outlook has reinforced, it has, for all of the 4 years that we've talked about it, the vast majority of our energy supply over at least the next 20-plus years, and probably for a long time beyond, will continue to come from carbon sources. From fossil fuels. And that being the case, my personal bias is that what we need to continue to commit to is developing the right technology and the opportunities that could be developed through technology to mitigate further the impact of burning fossil fuels.
Well, one of the ways we get people to show up and to speak and then also to have a conversation is we let you go on time. So I just want to thank Mark and Ray for being here today. Great presentation. Again, visit their website for all of the data that goes behind this, and we hope you'll come back again. So thanks very much. Please join me in thanking them.